Hello and welcome everyone. Welcome to my another webinar on Node.js. And in this webinar, we are going to talk about asynchronous Node.js pattern. I mean, how to deal with asynchronous behavior in Node.js, and what are the different ways to write the code, and what are the different ways in which you can optimally manage the code. So I hope you already familiar with the promises, callbacks, generators, async awaits, observables, all these things we are going to talk here. So what is asynchronous? First of all, asynchronous is like which is not time bound. You know, the synchronous operations A plus B equal to C, it's not doing anything related to the IO operation, disk operations, or event related operation. But whenever it comes to the reading a file or firing an HTTP call or writing a stream or any operation which involves the IO is asynchronous operation. Another way is that you wanted to capture some events happening onto your browser window. That is also asynchronous, right? Because that will be happening over the time whenever you are clicking onto the browser screen. Okay, so we see the AJAX calls using XHR, event emitter, streams, callbacks, events, and IO operations. So what are the different ways in which we can write the code in Node.js to deal with asynchronous code, asynchronous behavior? So first thing is a callback, right? So callback is actually a function being passed into another function, and it will returns once you get the value. So callback was being used extensively with Node.js 4 or 5. So here you just need to return a callback from the function, and whatever the value is being returned from function, you will capture that in the another function. Okay, so you just basic question in the Node.js that its loop is running 100 times, which is asynchronous operations, and inside that you are running asynchronous set timeout loop. So if you remove this iffy block, then I think you all know already know the answer, that it is going to print only 100 times, because you already executed the synchronous operations 100 times, but the set timeout need to execute now. So it will always get the value 100. Now I added a iffy block to capture the scope of each and every iteration, or you can remove the var to the let. So it will be block scoped, and you will be able to capture the value of each and every I, which is 1, 2, 3 up to 100. Okay, so another way of dealing with the asynchronous code is the promises. So if we go back to the past, we used to write AJAX call where we are checking the status code 200, ready state 4, then XML HTTP request object dot send to hit the APIs, to hit any URL to get the data. Then we started using callbacks, then we moving to the promises, because promise, your HTTP call, you can bind in the promise. If you got the response, then resolve it, otherwise reject it. So do something can be a file read call, can be any asynchronous operation which is returning a promise. It can be a file read, it can be API call, it can be a event or anything. So once you do dot, then you will, if the first callback is getting executed, means you got the response. So dot then will execute once you have the either a success from the promise, or either resolved promise, or either rejected promise. You can also do the chaining of the promises, which is simple. Just call the functions dot then dot then dot then. First promise, second promise. So whatever this promise is returning, that is being passed to the third promise. You can also pass the data. So here we are not passing anything in the first callback, but whatever the output you are getting from the first promise block, you can pass that to the second concurrent promise. Okay, so any one of them will fail, it will directly go to the catch block. So this is a promise chaining. Second will execute after the execution of first. They are not parallel, they are sequential execution of multiple promise, one after another. So async await is another enhancement on top of promise, and it is coming with ES7. maybe so we you don't need to deal with a dot then and then two different callbacks. So here you just need to use async with the function definition and await with the asynchronous operation. Something like this. So you need to, in the function definition, put async, and for each and every asynchronous operations, do await. This kind of scenario cannot be done with the promises. Here you are running two operations independently, and your third operations will happen once you get the data from A and B. This can be a scenario. So in for those kind of scenarios, either you can use a promise.all or just put them using async await. Await for this call, await for this call, and then you can use them for another call. So this execution will happen once you got the value of C, right? Which is going to wait for this particular await. So wait until this is done, wait until this is done, then only this third will execute. So earlier we had a problem in the promises that if you wanted to execute another promise, then you must have to wait for promise 1 and 2, right? So this scenario is not possible with the promises. Either you put them in the promise.all, even if you put them in the promise.all, then you need to wait for both of them. So we have a generators, right? Generators are the concept of ESX, where you are just putting asterisk before the function name and yielding the value. So generator is a pure example of a stream response which is coming over the time. You can yield the values 1, 2, 3, 4 each and every second. So whenever you just call this function, it is going to return an iterable object which is generator. So when you do the generator.next, it is going to give you the value and done value false. Foo, done. And so this, you can run the for of loop onto the generator. For of loop also do the same thing. It iterate on each and every iterable object and will check the value and done until unless the done value is true. So generator is another functions which is giving you the value over the time. So you can write some code where you are yielding the value per second and every 2 seconds. So then this function is something like and next iteration will happen whenever you do the dot next. So when you do the first dot next, it will give you the value foo. Now you again writing yield bar. So when you do the generator dot next again, then only you will get the value. So yield is actually pausing the execution. And when you do the dot next one time, it is running one by one. So instead of writing this again and again, you can run the for of loop onto the generator and get all the values. Another example of async await, using the promises. So here, I don't want to create a two lines of a code. I can wait for promise.all to happen completely. So here I'm using the promises. I mean, like there are 5 promises I need to run. Then I can put all of them and I'm waiting for both the values. And then I'm passing the product value, product ID onto the products. Right, so this is another asynchronous operation, this is also an asynchronous operation, this is also a synchronous operation. So this will not run until unless you got the value from this. This is not possible in the case of pure promises where we are not using async await. If you are using pure promises, then you need to always put the next instructions into the dot then block of first promise. Here it will wait because we have put a await, right? So wait until I got the response from this, then pass this product ID there. Okay, then we have a async waterfall also in the Node.js where you can just have an sequential callback execution. Callback 1, you got some data from that call, pass that data to the second callback. So it's like we have the promise chaining, right? So this is the callback chaining which is happening with async, which is coming with the core Node.js. Async.waterfall. Okay, so you always need to take care of the handling the rejections in Node.js, otherwise from Node.js 10 it will stop or abrupt your Node.js process. So like here I'm just doing main dot then. Main is actually a asynchronous function which is returning you the promise. but I'm just taking care of the success scenario, not handling the rejection scenario. And if this particular function explicitly returning a rejection, then you will get a warning or message that unhandled rejection promise, right? So you always need to handle the rejection also using the dot catch in the promise. So so there is a function promiseify node.js which can make any library promiseified. So read file fs is actually a callback based, but I wanted to make it as a promise based. I can pass that util.promiseify read file function. So once you promiseify it, read file async function is available which will return you the promise. So read file is a function, read file just put async in that string, append async in that string at the last, then that will be the new function which is going to return a promise. So that happens with the Redis client also, like Redis set key, get key, set async, get async. So any library, whatever you are making, whatever the library you are promiseifying, so there is a promiseify method, then you just need to put async after that method name. Now it is a promiseified version and it will return the promise. Same thing we are doing here. We are waiting for that promise. Once done, we are getting the response. Okay, so this particular async task, we can change this definition from promise chaining to the async await like this, independent functions. So this particular line, await function D will wait for the execution to be completed by value A, value B and value C, then only this instruction will execute. So if you wanted to replace the promise chaining with async await, go ahead with that. Okay. So this is all about the different behaviors which you can use in Node.js to write the asynchronous code.